I started to experiment with different drugs, and I started to drink alcohol every single day of my life just to get some type of escape from the way that I was living my life. Just because I was in denial that I had a lot of money. I had houses, I had cars, and I didn't have happiness. So I was trying to get high to escape from that, living that type of life. And it happened to be one day I was in a recording studio and I got into a fist fight with my own little brother. My own little brother, the same little brother that I brought from New Jersey to protect him from the streets of New Jersey. My same little brother that when he was getting in trouble selling drugs, I told my grandmother, send him out here with me. I would straighten him up. I got intoxicated and I got into a fight with my little brother to the point where I almost killed my own little brother. I had to send him to the hospital where they had to put staples in his head to put his head back together. But it happened to be a Muslim brother in the parking lot that time. He came to me. He calmed me down. He asked me what was my name. He asked me what was going on. And I told him my name was Mutar. And he asked me, was I a Muslim? And for some strange reason, I said, yes, I'm a Muslim. Even though I knew nothing about the religion of Islam, like I said, my mother and father converted to the religion of Islam. I had an uncle that was a Muslim, but the only thing he ever talked to us about Islam is that I'm a Muslim. This is my religion. The book is called the Quran, and we don't eat pork. So I told him, he said, since you're a Muslim, where do you go pray? I said, well, to be honest, I never ever went to a mosque before. He said, well, I'm going to invite you to the mosque. I want to bring you to the masjid. And I said, eventually, after his phone calls, he kept calling me. I rolled up in there, even in his own words. He said, when I came up to the masjid, to the mosque, I had about 30 friends with me. Because everywhere I went, I'm thinking everything's is the same. I'm thinking the people in the mosque are just like the people in the when I go to the record store. It's the same thing. So I rolled up in there with 30 deep. And I noticed when I got up in the mosque, I seen a sense of brotherhood. And I seen some type of seriousness that I didn't see in the streets, that I didn't see in the record companies. And I seen that the people was, they was real men, but they had a certain type of brotherhood, a certain type of respect for each other. They looked like they had some type of happiness and peace in their face. And this is what I was searching for. So after he gave me literature of Islam, he gave me the English translation of the Quran. When I read it, the English translation of the Quran, I knew that this was the book, this could not be the words of a man. And eventually, alhamdulillah, I accepted the religion of Islam. After accepting the religion of Islam, this was the first time in my life I ever felt some type of happiness. The first time in my life I ever had some type of discipline. And eventually I was able to leave the music industry. One of the things I do now is motivational speaking, and I try to do a lot of work with the youth from in America, Toronto, the Middle East, and I come to the UK often. The reason why I'm out here now, I came out here with the council in London and also the brother, they flew me out here to Birmingham. Well, I drove to Birmingham. I came out here basically to speak to the youth. And one of the reasons I want to speak to the youth is because you guys are having a problem with gang issues nowadays. Like the brother said that over the last few years, you guys had about 20-something murders, homicides in Birmingham. Now, to me, even 20-something bodies is way too much. It's too much. But coming from America, I wish that I could say in my neighborhood, it was only 20 people that died. I wish that I could say, man, I wish New Jersey or Los Angeles or Philadelphia was like Birmingham. And we knew that where we could have ended or we would have been heading so that we could turn our city around. I wish we could have said that because basically you guys still have a sign of hope. Because in Philadelphia alone, which is a small city, it might be the size of Birmingham. Last year alone, they had 375 murders in one small city. The majority of these people was teenagers. This is in 1 year. So for you guys can see where you're headed, that you guys are not too far behind from the States. It's up to you guys to say, man, this is my neighborhood. Do I want my neighborhood to get like Philadelphia, where over 360 people got murdered in 1 year? If you look at that number, it will have to be somebody in this room. It will have to be someone you know. It will have to be one of your brothers, one of your sisters, one of your family members, your father, your mother, because bullets don't have eyes on them. When they start doing drive-by shooting, the bullet don't have an eye on them, and it's going to hit whoever they want to hit. So you guys should be the ones that say, look here, we didn't get that bad as America. We didn't get that worse where we cannot turn our city around. But it's going to be up to you guys. For example, recently, a month ago, we had the police from Newham from London. They came to America because they're having a problem with Bloods and Crips. So they called me up. They said, look here, man, we brought you out here to speak to the people. Now, we want to know if you can bring us to L.A. so that we can speak to the people out there and they can speak to us. I said, who do you want to speak to? They said, we want to speak to the people that's involved in gang violence, or we want to speak to the people that started this type of stuff so that we can get an understanding of where London is heading. So I brung him out. I don't know if anybody ever heard of a movie called Training Day. It was a movie with Denzel Washington. He was a corrupt cop fighting against some gang members. And they was in a place called the Jungles. Now, the Jungles is a group of apartments with a bunch of palm trees, but it's like a maze. If you get into the Jungles, and if you're an enemy of the Jungles, and you go looking for your enemies, you want to get lost. Because there's no way you're going to know how to get up out of there. So it was a death trap. Many people from the that was the enemies of the Jungles, which is a predominantly blood neighborhood, they would go inside this neighborhood looking to see somebody with red or looking to fight, see an enemy, and they would never make it up out of the jungle. Most of the apartment buildings in there, the police from London, they seen it with their own eyes. Most of the apartment, every single apartment building they pointed, it had bullet holes in them. And when they asked him why do they call it the jungle, he had to explain. So one of the guys we introduced the police to was a guy named TJ Rogers, who was the founder of the Bloods in that neighborhood. He was around 50, 60 years old at the time, but even though he's not a gang member anymore, his grandkids are gang members. His sons are gang members. And the people respect him because he started this. But what TJ Rogers do now, he go around and do gang prevention. He speak to the youth, and he was able to speak to the police, and he started explaining, he started asking the police some questions. He said, let me ask you some questions about the gangs issue in England. He started to ask some questions about what type of violent crimes do they commit, what type of damage they do to their enemies, what type of stuff do they get involved in. He said, well, they stabbing each other. Every once in a while, you hear some gun crime, but the majority of the crime is knife crime. They jumping people. They doing petty crime. They robbing and stealing. He said, wow. He said, the same things that you saying out of your mouth, when I first joined the game, we was doing the same exact thing. We were just doing petty crime. We were just had a few knives. We were stabbing people, fighting each other. He said, but until it got to a level, nobody would pick up a knife anymore. He said it came to gunplay. We started murdering each other. The same way you started off, he said, I'm sorry to tell you this, but London is going the same way that we started off. And he said, pretty soon, you're going to hear nothing but gun crime. He said, pretty soon, you're going to hear that this person got murdered. This person got shot. He said, it's sad to see that you guys are heading down the same path that now we wish we would have never tread. We wish we would have never walked down that path. Because most of the youngsters, man, it might be fun at the beginning when they hanging on the corner and they got their little boys with them, they crew, they 17, they 18, they 15, they 13, another crew from this postcode come over, they beat them up. It start off fun, no doubt about it. I used to feel the same way. I was your age, I used to have fun that way. I used to get with my brothers and my cousin, we'd go to the next neighborhood, we'd beat up a person, 30 people, we'd jump at 5 people, we'd come back, steal their bikes, go back to our neighborhood, we'd smile. We'd stand on the corner of our blocks, we'd throw rocks at the cars, the grown men would get out and chase us, we would smile. Until eventually them grown men get out with bats and they start beating the little kids up like they grown men, we start saying, well, we need to find a new hobby. This type of game ain't fun no more. Until you start going to jump an individual and when you went on the wrong block, he put out a gun and he start shooting at you and you gotta run home. You start saying, well, this is not fun anymore. Because most of you guys not looking at where you guys are heading at. You looking for today, and you think that it's only going to be some good type of fun today, but what's going to happen when you roll up on another postcode and you far away from your house and he put a pistol in your face? Did you ever think about that sequence? Did you ever get a chance to think about what's going to happen to you when you standing on your block and the car turned around the corner with an AK-47 out the window during the drive-by shooting? Did you ever think about that? Do you ever think about while you repping your postcode that it would get to a point that all it takes is one individual from your postcode to put a gun on another person, take his life, now you want to get revenge, and then it goes on and on and on and it never stops? Did you ever think about that? Do you ever get to the point, did you think that you want to walk in the house and see your whole mother, father, your grandmother sleep in the bathtub? And you ask her, why are you sleeping in the bathtub? And they tell you, because last night it was bullets going through my house. And I was afraid that if I slept in a bed, that I would get hit by a bullet. Do you want this for your mom and your father, your grandparents? Are you that much of a gangster that you want that for your parents? Can you say that you want that for your parents? You should ask yourself, be honest with yourself, because this is where you guys are heading at. You guys are not too many years, well, I would say maybe 20 years behind. And I would say maybe not that, because now, like the brother said, you're finding some guns on the street. You're finding weapons on the street. But I don't think that the kids are looking at the consequences, man. I think you're looking at the fun that it is, the adrenaline rush you get when you walk home from school with 3 or 4 of your boys or 20 of your boys. It start off fun, but are you thinking about when you wake up one day and you see one of your right-hand mans in a wheelchair? Another one of your friends, he locked up for life. Another one of your friends, he get his face shot off in front of you.